Hello, my name is Danny Akin, and I have the joy of serving as president of Southeastern Baptist Theological Seminary in Wake Forest, North Carolina, a seminary that is known far and wide as a Great Commission seminary. You see, we believe that the best theological education takes place under the umbrella of the Great Commission. So everything you're doing, you're always asking the question, how does this class, how does this seminar, how does what we're doing fit into fulfilling the Great Commission? And the reason we do that is because we believe last words are meant to be lasting words. And the very last thing that the Lord Jesus said before he ascended back into heaven is found in Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. When it comes to theological education as a laying a foundation, we believe that obedience to the Great Commission involves obeying all aspects of the final marching orders of the Lord Jesus Christ. And of course, the heart of that is found in the imperative, make disciples. Now, because there are a number of participles orbiting around that command, we also believe that going, baptizing and teaching receives the force of an imperative as well. And again, when it comes to our assignment of doing good theological education, doing good ministry preparation, that command to teach is particularly relevant for us because it's comprehensive, and also it is critical because we're to observe all that the Lord has commanded. So we believe that our assignment is to produce and deploy a well-trained, well-rounded ministry. And at Southeastern, there are five things that are, again, foundational to what we are trying to do. We want to train up men and women who have the heart of a pastor, who have also the mind of a theologian, who also are passionate about evangelism and missions, and see all of that, again, under the umbrella of making disciples. So if that is the foundation, what are some essential components of doing good biblical and theological education? And I want to share 14 of those with you very, very quickly that, again, guide the ministry here at Southeastern Seminary. And I would pray will guide your seminary or your college as well. Number one, we want to train up men and women that are spiritually alive and growing. In other words, they should give evidence of being genuinely converted, of being born again, as John chapter 3 talks about, as Titus chapter 3 addresses in terms of our regeneration. In other words, we believe that one who would lead others to know, love, and obey the Lord Jesus must themselves be spiritual men and also spiritual women. Now, that means they have an intimate daily walk with the Lord Jesus Christ. They understand the value and the importance of the ministry of the Holy Spirit so that they can live the Spirit-filled life, Ephesians 5, 18. And they will bear the fruit of the Spirit, Galatians 5, 22 and 23. In other words, this life of a graduate of our schools should be one that is immersed in the spiritual disciplines of daily Bible reading, prayer, scripture, memorization, fasting, and also personal worship. And we also believe that the ambition of our students should be to love the Lord their God with all of their heart, with all of their soul, and with all of their mind. In other words, Great Commission Christians are also going to be Great Commandment Christians, loving the Lord first and foremost, but also loving their neighbors as themselves. If you want an Old Testament warn, I would say we're trying to train up men and women who look like Psalm 1. Number two, we want our graduates to be biblically knowledgeable. We want them to know what the Bible says about a subject, and we also want them to be asking the question when they are faced with an issue. Well, my first question is this: what does the Bible say? Now, we want them to be like this because we believe that 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17 informs us that all scripture is inspired by God. And therefore, we believe in the authority, the inerrancy, the infallibility, and the sufficiency of scripture for all of life in terms of our faith and also in terms of our practice. So we want them to have a good grasp both of the Old Testament and also the New Testament. In other words, we want them to know the Bible, and we want them to know how to apply the Bible to the everyday issues of life that they are going to confront, as well as training their people to think in biblical ways as well. Number three, we want them to be theologically grounded. In other words, we want them to have a good grasp of the Bible's theology. So we want them to know biblical theology. We want them to know systematic theology. We want them to know historical and practical theology as well. We want them to be able to articulate well both what they believe and also why they believe. In other words, as 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 15 tells us, they should be ready to give an answer to anyone who asks them for the reason of the hope that is in them. In other words, we want them to think well biblically. We want them to think well theologically as well. Why? Because the theological depth and maturity of a local church will never be any greater than that of its leaders. Number four, we want them to be didactically prepared. Since preaching is going to be the primary assignment, especially of the men that come to our schools, we want them indeed to think well and be able to proclaim that word well also. That's why I believe that a healthy and smart seminary would be committed to expository preaching, preaching the whole Bible, the whole counsel of God's Word. Often we say here at Southeastern, preaching the Bible book by book, chapter by chapter, verse by verse, phrase by phrase, word by word. And that also means that they need to be well trained to deliver God's good word. Now let's say it this way. They need to be able to deliver God's perfect word in a good and compelling way. So we want them to be well trained in terms of interpreting the Bible, explaining the Bible, illustrating the Bible, and applying the Bible as well. As one man said, we want them not only to know how to prepare messages which are biblical and Christ-centered, but also messages which are clear and understandable, which does mean they're going to have to carve out time to prepare these kinds of messages. I believe that we want to set as a goal 10 to 12 hours in the study in preparing to teach a passage of Scripture. My prayer is our schools will train them and inculcate in them that kind of devotion and that kind of commitment to biblical sermonic preparation. Number five, we want them to be historically informed. In other words, a servant of the church should be knowledgeable about major persons, major events, major movements, and major councils of church history. As Baptists, it is good for them to be familiar with Baptist history, not only worldwide, but also in their immediate local and contextual context as well. So we want them to be informed so that we learn from both the good things of our forefathers, but also the negative things so that we don't repeat the mistakes of the past. Not knowing history opens us up to a world of false teaching and susceptibility to being led astray. A good knowledge of history will show us where the church has dealt with these issues before and gives us guidance in how to deal with these issues today. Number six, we want our students to be evangelistically active. In other words, they should be personal witnesses and personal soul winners. They should be actively seeking to reach those who are spiritually lost with the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Furthermore, they need to understand the difference between the gospel and implications that flow out of the gospel. There are many things that flow out of the gospel in terms of ethics, social action, doing ministry within the church, but we need to be crystal clear on what is the gospel. That is the proclamation of the death, the burial, and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sins, and that anyone will be saved who repents of their sin and puts their faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ and the Lord Jesus Christ alone. Furthermore, I believe good evangelists will also be active in training others as well. So we want our graduates, we want those who leave our schools to know themselves how to share the gospel, but also to have a plan for training others to share the gospel as well. And of course, one of the best things they can do is take others along with them so that they're not only teaching them, they're modeling for their disciples how to share the gospel as well. Well, closely related to that is number 7. We want them to be mission-minded. We want them to have a passion for reaching the unreached with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We know that the Bible teaches that God loves all the peoples of the world. In fact, I believe that the Bible teaches that Jesus Christ died for every sin of every person who will ever be born and whoever lived in this world. And therefore, if that is the heart of our Savior for the nations, for the various people groups of the world, that needs to be our heart as well. And we need to be reminded, there's still more than 6,500 unreached people groups in the world today. There's still close to 3.5 billion people that have either limited access to the gospel or no access to the gospel. Again, we need to remind our students, there are places in the world where people will be born, they will live, they will die, they will go to hell, and they never even one time heard a clear presentation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I know that that is not acceptable to our Heavenly Father. That should not be acceptable to us either. I want pastors and I want church leaders who have the heart of a missionary. Number 8, we want our leaders and our graduates to be competent to lead. It is a truism. Everything rises or falls on leadership. And so those who lead our church need to be competent to lead and competent to motivate and competent to mobilize the church to move forward in fulfilling the vision of the church. They need to be able to equip the saints to do their work of the ministry, which means, I believe, being very, very gifted in delegating. In other words, a minister of the church, a leader in the church, cannot do all the work. You will burn out. You will not be competent to do that because though you are gifted and they are gifted in some areas, they're not as gifted in others. That's why I like what my hero Adrian Rogers used to say, A leaders hire A people, B leaders hire C people, and A leaders hire A people to do their job. Do they give them guidance and direction? Absolutely. Do they cast the vision so that the church knows where it's going? Absolutely. Do they give them principles and guidelines and strategies for fulfilling that vision? Absolutely. But they basically turn over leadership to those who are competent to lead in their particular areas, and they provide oversight of that. So that's, again, bottom line, just doing good discipleship, training up disciples who can also do the work of the ministry that God has called them to do and that we then have gifted them and trained them to do as well. Number 9, I want us to send out students who are and graduates who are people oriented. In other words, we want to train men and women who know how to relate well to others, and especially others who are different than they are. In other words, to say it this way, we want to train up men and women that have a true and genuine love for all people. They recognize, as Acts 10:34 says, our God is no respecter of persons. They recognize, as Galatians 3:28 says, that when it comes to those whom God loves and whom God wants to save, there's neither male nor female, there's neither slave or free, there's neither Jew or Greek. All are one in Christ, and therefore we pursue an agenda on earth that looks like the church in heaven. In fact, we're fond of saying at this school, we want to build churches or at least train students who will go out and build churches on earth that look like the eschatological eternal church in heaven. You say, what does that look like? Go read Revelation chapter 5 and Revelation chapter 7, and you will see the goal that we are pursuing for the glory of God. By the way, if you're going to be good as a people person, that means you will also know how to obey Ephesians 4:15, where you speak the truth, but you speak the truth in love. Number 10, we want our graduates to be administratively competent. In other words, you need to learn to work well with others, in particular those that you train up to be in positions of leadership as a part of your inner circle of leadership. That means that you are equipping them. That means you are supporting them. That means you are supervising them. But as I said a moment ago, you're also delegating to them responsibilities that you don't have to be involved in except as a supervisor, because God has saved them, God has gifted them, and you have equipped them to do their work of the ministry. Let me just say it to you this way. If you are a person in ministry that has to be involved in everything and has to be doing everything, you will limit the impact that you can make for the gospel and the cause of Christ. Because again, you can't do everything. Furthermore, God never intended for you to do everything. So again, one of the things that we want to train our students to do well is learn to delegate, learn to use others. I like to say it this way: train others, equip others, then set them free for the glory of God that they can soar for the fame of His name. Number 11, we want to train up men and women that are competent to equip others. Of course, the foundation here is found in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 16, where leaders in the church are to, again, train up and equip others to do their work of the ministry. And so we want to equip a student body and graduates who are able to be deployed and then able to develop others to be deployed to do their work of the ministry. It is indeed the multiplication mandate that we receive, I believe, from the Word of God. Number 12, and this is so vitally important, lifelong students. Lifelong students. In other words, we want to inculcate, put into the DNA of our students and our graduates study habits that will accompany them the rest of their lives. In other words, we need to help them understand that when you come to a college that prepares you for ministry, or you come to a seminary that prepares you for ministry, we cannot teach you everything you need to know in 2, 3, 4, 5, or even a dozen years. Our goal is to teach you to teach yourself. Our goal is to train you to be a lifelong student. So you understand that when I graduate from my institution that God called me to go to learn and be trained, this is not the end. It is just the beginning. So one of the things I would encourage you to challenge your students to do is continue to build their libraries as God gives them financial resources to do so, because they need to continually be studying, continually be learning, continue to be matured, and recognizing this side of heaven, I will never arrive, but I'm always reaching for that mark of a fully well-orbed, well-trained minister of the gospel. Number 13, denominationally knowledgeable. In other words, in their particular context, we want to train them to what? Partner with others that are committed to the same biblical and theological convictions that they are. We often say within the Southern Baptist Convention, we can do more together than we can do apart. And that is absolutely true. We see this again modeled in the book of Acts. And so it is my prayer that those who go out, again, will not become spiritual silos where they're not engaging others, but actually they're looking to see how can we work together to evangelize an unreached area, an unreached people group? How can we work together to do better theological education, to do better evangelism training, to do better discipleship training. And so we recognize that though we are over and leading a particular local church, we will do that better when we cooperate and work together with other like-minded ministers and churches. Finally, we want to train up men and women that are culturally aware. In other words, good servants of the Lord Jesus Christ are aware of the greater evangelical world. They're aware of the greater Christian world, but they're also very much aware of their particular cultural context as well. In other words, if they're going to share the gospel well and effectively, they've got to know who it is they're trying to reach, who it is they're trying to disciple in their particular context. Now, again, some things are common. All of humanity is sinful. All of humanity has basic needs that are true anywhere and everywhere. All of humanity is wired to ask certain questions like, who am I? Why am I here? What is this all about? Is there life after death? Is there a God? And I don't care where you go, all cultures will be asking those kinds of questions, although they'll vary depending upon the particular context in which one is living. What we want to do, again, is train men and women that, above all, know well the scriptures. But we also want them to know well their cultural context, that they can be the most effective in sharing the gospel that they can possibly be. Now, there are many other things that, of course, could be added to this list, but I'll say this. If our graduates are men and women that look like these 14 characteristics, men and women who are going to do all that they do on the foundation of the final marching orders of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that is the Great Commission, I'll tell you this. I will be one very happy and very pleased seminary president. I suspect that we will have one happy and pleased seminary faculty, because if they look like this and they function like this in their particular ministry context, I believe God will honor them, God will bless them, and God will use them to reach the nations with the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for letting me share my heart. I love the fact that we are all in this together. I know I need you. I pray that I can contribute things to help you do what you do better. But bottom line, we have a wonderful commander-in-chief whose name is King Jesus. He has promised us that the nations, indeed, all of them, will be gathered around the throne forever and ever, adoring the same Heavenly Father, worshiping the same Savior, indwelt by the same Holy Spirit. If that's what all of heaven and all of eternity is going to be like, let's work hard to begin to give this earth a little touch of heaven right now, today. God's blessings. Thank you for allowing me to share my heart with you today.